Welcome back to the class. And in the previous two sessions, we started the discussion on cultural globalization, and we will continue with the same theme in this class or in this week, as well as in the next week, because I want to devote around 10 lectures in order to introduce you or to discuss some of the substantive themes associated with the cultural globalization. And I made this point very clear in the very beginning of the previous two lectures that cultural globalization really represents a very significant component of globalization literature. And unlike, say, during 1990s or during 80s, when globalization was seen predominantly as an economic process, now increasingly social scientists realize and admit that the cultural dimension of globalization is equally important. And we are in our everyday encounter, in our everyday life, we are actually witnessing the implications of globalization around us, including in our own life. So we had two sessions in the previous days. One in which I introduced this concept of culture and how varied and how divergent are the meanings associated with this particular term. And in the second class, I discussed a broad overview of the whole idea of cultural globalization, trying to understand it as a territory, its connection with identity formulation, and that of culture. Okay, so in today's class, I want to introduce you to a very important work, yet a highly controversial work titled The Clash of Civilizations. And this, why I need to introduce you to this work is of two reasons. One is that it is an extremely popular, rather infamous or famous, it depends upon which ideological position that you want to locate yourself. It has been an extremely influential work, controversial work by one of the leading political scientists of our times, Samuel P. Huntington. So he puts forward a very provocative argument. Many people say that it's a very divisive argument, which portrays a very dismal picture of the future of the whole world, and it created quite a lot of discussions and debates. And second reason is not only because he is putting forward something very controversial, but he is putting forward a cultural argument, okay, about the future of the world, future of globalization, and how different types of conflicts might arise. He is providing a kind of a culturalist explanation, an explanation based on values, explanation based on what he calls it as a kind of a civilizational fault lines. So in that sense, it is important for us to understand that why a scholar like Samuel Huntington had prepared or have proposed such kind of a work, where he wants to where his thesis revolves around the whole question of culture rather than economy or rather than politics. So in this session we are going to look at Samuel P. Huntington, and most of the material that I have used is taken from his own writings, because his this work came up out in different publications. There are some small excerpts are available, his own smaller articles are available, and then he published this whole book titled This Clash of Civilization. So mostly I am taking from his own work. So he first published it in 1993 in this journal titled The Foreign Affairs, the article titled The Clash of Civilizations. And you know, it's a question mark. He's not exactly saying that okay, what you are witnessing today or what you are going to witness today will be a clash of civilizations, but he's proposing a kind of a tentative explanation. Then he later expanded this thesis in 1996 in the book with title The Clash of Civilizations and the Remaking of World Order, where he elaborates the argument. He expands the scope of his argument, and then talking about the how this clash based on civilizational values is going to kind of change the whole world order that we are familiar with. And as I mentioned earlier, it has been a highly influential as well as a controversial work. Huntington has been, you know, criticized enormously by a host of scholars from various vantage points. Many people, we will have a last slide in which we look at the kind of a criticisms leveled against Huntington. But, you know, people criticized him for from various theoretical point of view. People even criticized him for propounding a very, you know, nefarious kind of theory, a very negative, nefarious kind of theory for his own personal ambition. He wanted to be seen as somebody, you know, advising American security forces. So there were even arguments questioning his moral integrity. Okay, but nevertheless, it became highly influential. This definitely influenced a host of you know, strategic thinkers and then analysts and then even the public imagination about what would be the future of the world, how should America, you know, must reposition itself, what should be their, you know, perspectives or approach towards a host of other countries and other things. So it places cultural incompatibility in the center of global conflicts. So this is again, as I mentioned earlier, he's proposing a kind of an explanation which revolves around the concept of culture. And this was something quite, you know, unusual in that sense, because earlier it was the theorizations were based on economic difference of opinion based on economic positions or political positions or strategic positions. But he's proposing something, or he proposed something quite new and radical, and that kind of created a lot of controversy. So what is he saying? Now, all these are his own, you know, excerpts from his own writings. So, it is my hypothesis, Huntington says, it is my hypothesis that the fundamental source of conflict in this new world will not be primarily ideological or primarily economic. The great divisions among humankind and the dominating source of conflict will be cultural. Okay, so why is he talking about ideological and economic? Because we know that if you look into the post-World War scenario, the rise of two huge, you know, ideological blocks. One was led by the USA, the democratic capitalist bloc. The other one was led by the USSR, the communist bloc. So the whole Cold War that we have witnessed from say 1950s till 1990s till the disintegration of USSR, it was mostly understood as a kind of conflict, tension, simmering tension emerging from incompatible ideological as well as political as well as economic reasons, because ideologically they were very different, politically they were very different, and their overall orientation towards economic structure was completely different. So with the war, with the fall of Berlin Wall, you know, it's a symbol, its destruction was a symbol of the collapse of Soviet Union, the collapse of communist bloc, and then you no longer have this bipolar world. You have only a unipolar world where the US was the unquestionable leader. So he says that unlike this kind of a scenario of where the ideological or economic factors are in the center, he is proposing a division. That's a great division among humankind, and the dominating sources of conflict will be cultural. Nation states will remain the most powerful actors in world affairs, but the principal conflicts of global politics will occur between nations and groups of different civilizations. So this is his, you know, putting forward a very dismal picture, a very maybe you can call it as a dubious picture, you can call it as a very, you know, a nefarious kind of a depiction, a very grim reality that the nation states will remain to be influential. They will continue to be important players in the world affairs, but principal conflicts, the kind of reasons for countries to engage in battles and wars, will be less of economic or political reasons, but more of the kind of reasons emerging from different civilizational aspects. So conflicts of global politics will occur between nations and groups of different civilizations. Conflicts between princes, nation states and ideologies in the past were primarily conflicts within Western civilization, Western civil war. So he is providing a kind of a European, the history of the West, looking into how say before the advent of nation states during the medieval period, how there were constant, you know, battles or wars between different princely countries and princely states. And then later it became during First World War, even before that it became wars between different nation states. And in the post 1950s and during the era of Cold War, okay, what you saw was kind of a simmering tension or low kind of low key conflicts on the basis of ideological differences between the USA bloc and the USSR bloc. But he's saying that all these things happened within the Western civilization as a kind of Western civil war. And this Western civilization, it's an important term that you need to keep it in mind. Then he argues that with the end of the Cold War, international politics moves out of its Western phase, and its centerpiece becomes the interaction between the West and non-Western civilizations and among non-Western civilizations. So he argues that after the end of Cold War, the kind of international politics which was centered around this European, this tussle between European powers, USSR and USA, is moving out of the confines of West, and it is becoming an interaction between the West and non-Western civilizations and among the non-Western civilizations. So world will be shaped in large measures by the interactions among 7 or 8 major civilizations. Okay, so this includes the Western, the Confucian, Japanese, Islamic, Hindu, Slavic Orthodox, Latin American and possibly African civilizations. And you know that he is not mentioning the Christian civilization. Instead, he is using the term Western, with the inherent understanding that the Christian civilization is what the Western civilization really represents. Now, he puts forward this argument that the kind of conflicts and wars and then battles that we have been witnessing so far, they are going to change its character, and what we are going to witness in the coming in the future would be of a completely different type, emerging from completely different reasons, emerging from the kind of incompatibility of different cultures based on different civilizational ethos. Now he's answering a host of questions. Why should there be a clash of these civilizations? We know that if you look into the history, all these 6 or 7 or 8 civilizations, as he talks about, you can identify them as large geographic areas comprising of larger either one state or more than one states. So they are all representing distinct geographic areas. And why is he saying that there is going to be a clash of civilizations? First, he argues, differences among civilizations are not only real, they are basic. Civilizations are differentiated from each other by history, language, culture, tradition, and most important, religion. So he is presenting a very essentialistic argument that these civilizations or the cultural roots of these countries, of these societies, are something, not only that they are real, but they are basic. They are so fundamental, they are so foundational, that a particular set of people of a particular country, society, how do they behave, what do they believe in, what are their predispositions towards a host of other things, all these things will be fundamentally decided by their civilizational ethics and their civilizational values. And it's not only that they are differentiated from each other by history, by language, culture, tradition, and most importantly, religion. And he places a lot of emphasis on this significance of religion. Second, the world is becoming a smaller place. And I don't think that I need to elaborate that, because the very core argument of this course on globalization is that the globe is becoming a smaller place. The interactions between people of different civilizations are increasing. These increasing interactions intensify civilizational consciousness and awareness of differences between civilizations and commonalities within civilizations. So he's saying that unlike the past, Okay, unlike the past where different countries, different cultures were contained or were confined in separate geographic areas, and then they were comfortably leading their life. In comparison with such a scenario, globalization has brought in much more heightened levels of interaction. Okay, interaction through communication, interaction through, you know, flow of articles, ideas, people, goods, services. Okay, and economic activity, and in a sense, so in that sense, we are coming into contact with people of other civilizations, and there is an intensification of civilizational consciousness. So everybody is becoming more and more aware about the kind of things that really bind us together, and how people are different from others, how we are different from others, how are our values different from the values of others. Okay, so this whole idea of the other and the self is emerging more and more prominently in a globalized world according to Huntington. Third, the processes of economic modernization and social change throughout the world are separating people from long-standing local identities. They also weaken the nation-state as a source of identity. In much of the world, religion has moved in to fill this gap, often in the form of movements that can be called fundamentalist. So this is another very powerful argument that the world that we are seeing today is undergoing significant transformations. There is major economic modernization taking place, and people are being lifted out of their traditional society. There's a very important term by name disembedding. We will discuss that later when we discuss Anthony Giddens and Ulrich Beck and others. So increasingly people are separated, or they are lifted out of their traditional roots and their traditional cultures. And nation state, the identity of nation state also is weakening, because then people are looking for a stronger sense of identity for them, and religion is stepping into that. So in contrast to a kind of an argument put forward by Max Weber that the whole world is undergoing a process of secularization, okay, where the religion will lose its significance and religion will be confined only to your private sphere, what we are witnessing according to Huntington is that religion is becoming more and more prominent, and especially in the form of movements that can be called as fundamentalists. Okay, so fundamentalist movement in every religion is asking for greater role of religion to be played in everyday activities. They want the societies to go back to the fundamentals of their religion. Fourth, the growth of civilizational consciousness is enhanced by the dual role of the West. On the one hand, the West is at peak of power. Okay, when Huntington Price writes this, they are at the peak of the power. At the same time, however, and perhaps as a result, a return of to the roots phenomenon is occurring among non-Western civilizations. So he's saying that almost every non-Western civilization is kind of deeply disturbed by the emergence of or the rise of Western societies, and that provokes them or that encourages them to look inward and then search for their own civilizational roots. Fifth, cultural characteristics and differences are less mutable, hence less easily compromised and resolved than political and economic ones. So this is again a very important argument. He would argue that the cultural characteristics emerging out of your ethnicity, your religion, your caste, your linguistic affiliation, these are very difficult to change, unlike differences arising out of ideological or economic reasons. You can negotiate, you can convince others, you can encourage others to change their positions with respect to ideological or economic reasons, but factors associated with culture are very, very hard to change. Okay, they are very hard to change, they can't really change. Finally, economic regionalism is increasing. The importance of regional economic bloc is likely to continue to increase in the future. On the one hand, successful economic regionalism will reinforce civilizational consciousness. On the other hand, economic regionalism may succeed only when it is rooted in a common civilization. So he must be having in mind, say, examples like European Union or this oil producing countries union, or similarly the kind of a regional economic blocks which want to present itself as a single economic unit and with the aim to facilitate globalization transaction. But he says that they will function well only when it is rooted in a common civilization. For example, this European Union, Huntington would argue, all the 26 or 27 countries are able to stick together as a union because they are all, bounded by a common Western civilization, underpinned by Christianity. And that is why maybe a Muslim majority country like Turkey found it very difficult to get a membership in European Union. As people define their identity in the ethnic and religious terms, they are likely to see an us versus them relations existing between themselves and the people of different ethnicity of religion. So this is the point that we discussed so far. In a global context, in a globally integrated world where about people from other society, other countries, you have to interact with them either digitally or physically, you are supposed to deal with their business, your culture, there is a flow of cultural ideas, idioms, media, entertainment, everything, and then that likely to produce this whole binary between this us versus the them, relations existing between themselves and the people of different ethnicity or religion. The clash of civilization thus occurs at two levels. At the micro level, adjacent groups along with fault lines between civilizations struggle violently over the control of territory and each other. At the macro level, states from different civilizations compete for relative military and economic power, struggle over control of international institutions and third parties, and competitively promote their particular political and religious values. So he says that this clash of civilizations can take place at two levels. One is a kind of a micro level where adjacent groups or countries who represent this different kind of civilizational belongings can fight with each other, and that's what he uses the term fault lines. He would explain how in the Western, in the European context, there are this fault line on the one side between more economically advanced and more modern Western Europe and the Eastern Europe, which is less advanced, which many of these countries were under the influence of USSR. So he identifies a kind of a fault line running through these countries. Okay, and he says that the countries who are on adjacent to each of these lines are more prone to enter into conflict. And at a international level as well, there is possibility that these countries belonging to different civilizations might compete with each other for greater control over resources and other things. As the ideological division of Europe has disappeared, the cultural division of Europe between the Western Christianity on the one hand and Orthodox Christianity and Islam on the other hand has emerged. So this is what I was just mentioning. He talks about a fault line that distinguishes between the Europe with the Western Christianity, mostly Catholic and Protestant, which were more modern, including Germany, France, England, and these important countries on the one side, and a host of other countries. So Huntington is talking about the major ideological division between the Western Europe, Europe and the countries with Catholic and Protestant religious backing, and a set of other countries where the Orthodox Christianity and Islam really are prominent. So he argues that this is a very important fault line along with the future conflicts might arise. The people to the north and west of this line are Protestant or Catholic. They shared common experience of European history: feudalism, the Renaissance, the Reformation, the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, the Industrial Revolution. On the other hand, the Orthodox Christians and the Muslims are different historically as well as culturally. So this is a very important argument, because when we talk about the rise of modernity, when we talk about enlightenment, when we talk about industrial revolution, colonialism, all these forces or all these processes primarily took place in the Western Europe, okay, in maybe four or five important countries: the Netherlands, the Portuguese, the Spain, the England, the the Germany, France. Okay, these are the major countries in which all these important intellectual as well as economic and political transformations underwent. A host of other countries towards this the other part of Europe, the northern, the Eastern Europe and Eastern European countries, and host of other countries, they were historically and culturally different. That's what Huntington argues. Now, century-old military interaction between the West and the Islam, including the war on terror, is unlikely to decline. Now, the most important point that he puts forward is the kind of a tension between the Islam and the Christian civilization. Islam and the Christian civilization, which he argues, is only going to intensify. And this, this has a much long past, starting from the Crusades, the kind of long-lasting, conflicts, religious conflicts between Christians and Muslims in the Central Europe. And so he would argue that this war on terror, this conflict between Western countries and the Muslim countries will only increase. And then he gives the latest example the Iraq invasion by the USSR, sorry, USA, and the latest the war on terror. He presents them as extremely important indications or extremely important illustrations. So the West is in effect is using international institutions, military power and economic resources to run the world in ways that will maintain Western predominance, protect Western interest and promote Western political and economic values. So he says that the West is in a very comfortable position to control everything, because West has a kind of hegemony over international institutions, whether it is UN or World Bank or any other institution or IMF, and they are able to safeguard their dominance over others, and other societies, other countries will not be able to really stand up to this kind of economic and as well as political dominance. So the conflict between the West and the rest, and the response of non-Western civilization to Western power and values, become important. So what he proposes is a kind of a long-lasting conflict between the West and the rest. So the rest, it includes a host of other civilizational other countries with different civilizational orientations and roots. But he argues that the primary contention, the primary conflict will be between the rest, between the West and the rest of the society. And he talks extensively about Islamic civilization and characterizes it as violent. And he has a set of reasons why there is the Islamic civilization is characterized more with violence, or why that you will find more and more instances of violence or conflict in the Western, in the Muslim civilization. He has a list of reasons, which many of them are highly problematic, which kind of essentializes the argument to certain innate features of Islam, and the kind of value orientations of Islam, and a host of other things. But he has this very important tendency of depicting Muslim society as anti-democratic, or Muslim societies are inherently incompatible with the values of modernity, like individualism, liberalism, secularism, and democracy. He presents all these arguments and saying that we need to, or the Western countries need to really brace for a new kind of conflict. Okay, not the kind of conflict that you are familiar with, not the kind of conflict that were fought on the basis of ideological or economic reasons, but the emerging conflict will be based on civilizational values, because these different set of values are quite different. You can't really bridge them, and the conflicts will now increasingly revolve around the kind of a cultural question. And we know that this 9/11 attack, where these Twin Towers were brought down in the city of New York, and then that led to a completely new, different turn in the international developments, where with America declaring this war on terror, and American forces were sent to across the places, and this terrorism became a global phenomenon. So and then later you have seen this rise of ISIS, this Islamic State, with a very very, very prominent anti-democratic, anti-modern or anti-liberal kind of values, and which involves significant kind of violence, and especially targeted against the West. So Huntington's argument really became very popular in that in this larger context, where increased kind of violence, increased magnitude of violence, increased violence, basically emerging from religious differences, basically emerging from by taking inspiration from religious values, became more and more prominent. So Huntington emphasizes, so on the basis of all these points that Huntington provides to us, a kind of a warning. Okay. It's not only a kind of a very scholarly analysis, but rather it's a kind of very important warning as well, what needs to be done. So Huntington emphasized upon the need for tightening immigration and assimilating immigrants and minorities so as to increase civilizational coherence. So he, after this very academic elaboration on the basis of historical and political reasons why that the new type of conflict would be very different, then Huntington moves on to prescribe certain policy initiatives, and this becomes even more problematic, because you know that it is not very easy to prescribe policy decisions when these kind of matters. No social scientists would immediately translate their sociological understanding into very specific policies, because these policies will have much larger unseen consequences. So one has to be very careful about it. But here Huntington has a set of very important, very controversial policies. For example, he argues for the tightening of immigration, okay, and he argues for the assimilation of immigrants and minorities into the say mainstream culture. And how these arguments became important now, especially in the US, with Donald Trump becoming president. We know these is exactly the same arguments that are becoming more and more evident. And he favored Americanization and denounced multiculturalism, Western technological and military superiority over other civilizations, non-interference in the affairs of other civilizations, empowering Atlantic partnership between US and Europe, limiting the expansion of Islamic Confucian states, and exploiting the difference between these two civilizations. So it's a very aggressive kind of policies that he is putting forward, that he wants to see to that the Western domination continues at any cost. He wants to ensure that the Western dominance is preserved, and the West does whatever is possible at their disposal to keep other forces, keep other societies under its control. And that's why it's a very problematic statement. It's not really Western centric or Eurocentric, but it's a very naked form of political power, naked expression of political power. He favored Americanization. Okay, he wants the American influence to spread across the globe. He's absolutely clear about it. And then he denounced multiculturalism. Okay, the argument promoted by a lot of liberals who argued that every culture must be respected, and he's clearly against all these positions. And the Western technological and military superiority over others, and non-interference in the affairs of other civilizations. So America or other civilizations must be left alone and should not interfere in their affairs as long as it does not affect the American interest. And limiting the expansion of Islamic Confucian state and exploiting the differences between these two civilizations. So these are the kind of very specific policies, suggestions that he put forward to that of the American establishment. And no wonder Huntington became a darling of many of the very right-wing policymakers of the US, because this is coming from a well-known political scientist, something that was something so dear to their ideas. They also wanted their foreign policy and then military strategies to be something very similar to this. Now, what are the kind of criticisms? Of course, as I mentioned, Huntington was severely criticized from a wide variety of people from across the spectrum. His arguments were criticized on the basis of on intellectual basis, on academic basis, on political ground, on various grounds. It was his arguments were criticized. So Huntington's emphasis on ever-present probability of a war between civilizations represent a fear that is deeply rooted in political realism. So this is a very important argument that he always, he warns you of an imminent crisis, or he warns you of an imminent, set of violence and aggression that is emerging from this incompatible values. And scholars argue that this is specifically coming from a political realism. It is informed by this larger framework of political realism. It doesn't really look into how these ideas change, or how various other factors play important role in deciding this outcome. So that is one set of important questions. Then the clash of civilization thesis is Orientalist. Edward W. Said claims that the epistemology of othering underlying Huntington's thesis is problematic, as labels, generalizations and cultural assertions are finally inadequate. So there's no doubt that Huntington's thesis is Orientalist. Okay, and I hope you are familiar with Edward Said's work, the very important work, the monumental work titled Orientalism by Edward B. Said, who argued about how the knowledge produced about the Oriental countries by the West was a product of their cultural and intellectual and political dominance over the West. So he very vehemently criticizes, stringently criticizes, Huntington for reproducing this kind of an Orientalist ideas, that the West is everything positive, it's progressive, it's democratic, it is oriented towards freedom, whereas the rest is all stands for all opposite to that. So this kind of a trope of binary qualities has been the central form of Huntington's thesis, and a host of scholars have criticized that. Then this monolithic conceptions of civilizations which neglect the polycentric structure of both worlds. Huntington ignores internal dynamics, plurality and myriad complexities of Islam and the Muslim world. So it's again maybe one of the fundamental criticisms against Huntington's argument. So he presents the Muslim world as a monolithic entity, saying that all Muslim societies are deeply religious, they are completely governed by the ethos of Islam, and that is why they will act or they can act only in certain forms. And we know that any cursory examination into the Muslim world, a cursory examination into the history of Muslim world will reveal the kind of enormous diversities, enormous complexities, how there are so much of differences of opinions, so much of conflict within Islamic societies, how democracy can or democracy has taken deep roots in many of the Muslim societies. So Huntington has no patience or Huntington has no interest in analyzing these complexities. Okay, he just believes in labels, saying that the Western European societies or the US, they are all pro-democratic, they are all for progress and everything good, whereas other societies, especially Islamic societies, are all standing for the everything that is bad and negative. So Huntington reduces multiple causes of inter and intranational conflicts, thereby essentializing the civilizational factor as the prime reason. So he overlooks a host of other reasons, could be economic or strategic or other reasons, and then underplay the significance of all these factors, and then overemphasize this religious or cultural features as the prime reasons. And then Huntington's thesis is in fact an enemy discourse that looks for new enemies. So Huntington has been criticized thoroughly, very strongly for his moral bankruptcy. There are even people who argued that Huntington wanted to have some more coveted places or coveted positions in the American defense or strategic establishment. That is why he wanted to create this kind of a fear mongering. He was indeed creating a kind of a fear. He was a fear monger, talking about the imminent or ever present danger from the other civilization. So he wanted some important positions in that. So there are a lot of criticisms aimed at him presenting as a kind of an enemy discourse, which always wants to look for new enemies, because without an enemy, without a perceived or a real or imaginary enemy, no such narration can really exist. So as I mentioned, Huntington's thesis has been extremely influential, very popular, but at the same time extremely controversial. A host of studies have criticized Huntington's argument by looking at very specific locations, specific histories, but here Huntington has no patience for such kind of elaborate nuance analysis. Rather, he has this larger meta theoretical argument, which is extremely problematic. Okay, so we are winding up this class here, but I want you to keep this point in mind that Huntington places the whole question of culture into the central place of this whole discourse about global development and future of the global order. Okay, so let us close here and then meet in the next class. Thank you.